Would you just begin speaking your love to Him and your praise to Him? We just praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We honor you today. We give you glory. We give you glory. We give you glory. If you'd like to stand and worship today, great. If you just need to be seated, that's fine. But let's just take a minute. It's just so easy to be so busy. Lord, we love you. Lord, we love you. Lord, we just worship you. We worship you this night. You are our center. Thank you.
Thank you.
just been reflecting back over this last year. And God is a God of faithfulness. God is a God of restoration. Let's just declare this together. All my life you have.
Thank you. so good to us. All our lives you've just been faithful. And no matter what we walk through, the good times, the challenges, Lord, you've just been so faithful. So today we just say thank you. Thank you. And Lord, this morning we want to pray for our nation. It's in such a turmoil, such upheaval right now. I pray that you strengthen our president and the leadership of the nation, God. That you just give them wisdom and direction. I speak to the unrest and the rioting and the destruction. I just say stop in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. So Lord, we just pray for your anointing and your presence to cover our nation, God. We need you desperately. Turn this nation back to yourself, Lord, we pray. And again, we just say thank you so much, Lord, for your faithfulness to us. Thank you. Why don't you go ahead and be seated. I'm going to invite the ushers to come as we continue to worship the Lord in giving. We're going to sing through this song again. Thanks so much for your faithfulness and honoring the Lord. Lord, we give you praise. We give you thanks. We just return back to you what is really yours anyway, in tithes and in offerings, Lord, missions giving. Would you just take this offering and really reach around the world with it? And we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
talked to Bob and Bernie's house, texted.
Well, it's good to see us getting back together again. I know we've been doing this for several weeks, but it's just good to see all of you here. And I just want you to know it truly has been our joy to serve here for almost a year. I think we came like the third Sunday in June or something like that in last summer, and it is really, really been our joy and honor to be here.
Ours too.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. I really encourage you to be here next week to welcome Pastor Chad and his family. I know a lot of his family is here today, but I talked to Pastor Chad last night. He's just looking forward to being with you folks. And you're in for a treat next week. Dave Phillips is our superintendent. He's a great preacher. You'll enjoy he and Colleen very much.
Pastor?
Yeah.
Thank you. You're on that.
You bet.
And I also spoke with Pastor Chad, and they will be getting here Monday evening sometime. And so if anyone wants to show up and help unload the U-Haul, show up here at the park.
Any approximate time?
I think they're planning on getting here probably not earlier than 3.
No, earlier than 3.
No, later than 3 is what it's told me. But right around 3. So right around 3. So if you're available, show up and give a hand.
You bet. Thanks, Terry. Appreciate that. Some of you have asked, and I don't think I've ever shared this before. Some of you have asked, you know, what are you going to be doing from now on? And we just have a lot of things going on right now. But one thing I haven't mentioned to you before is a ministry that Corlin and I started a little over a year ago. And it's a ministry to leaders. Okay, in fact, it's called Leader to Leader Ministries. It's specifically designed for pastors, but also missionaries and evangelists. Christian leaders who may be struggling, maybe just needing some encouragement. I don't know if you're aware, but a significant number of pastors, especially, are leaving the ministry every month. And this is across denominational lines, of course. I'm not just talking about the Assemblies of God, but every month a number of pastors, and these are individuals, men and women, who've been called of God, ordained of God, but because of situations, maybe depression, discouragement, church conflict, financial problems, health issues, any number of things, and they finally decided, you know what, I can't do this anymore. And that's a tragedy to me. Corlin and I went through our own challenge about 7 or 8 years ago. We just hit a spot in ministry where we really said, you know what? I don't know if we can do this anymore. And God really helped us. We went out to a counseling center in Seattle and received some help for a short period of time, but then also just friends and a loving church family really stepped up and helped us and brought us to a place of health again. Of course, the Lord did that. But that really laid this on our hearts to reach out to pastors and leaders and encourage them. So we have that going, and I spend a fair amount of time each week on the phone with pastors and leaders, just encouraging them, strengthening them. We'll be doing a fair amount of traveling once this COVID thing lifts
and just providing retreats for leaders as well. If you'd like to give toward that ministry, you'd be more than welcome to. Again, I don't push that a lot, you know, give to our ministry. But if you'd like to, you can contact us, and I can give you more information about that. But I just have a heart for pastors. I want to see them stay strong. You know, Jesus said, he was quoting a minor prophet, but he said, strike the shepherd and the sheep scatter. And that's what happens. Oftentimes the enemy targets the pastor or a leader because he wants to scatter the sheep. And so we don't want to see that happen. So thanks for letting me share that, just a heart that we have for pastors. I want to talk to you today about dreams. In fact, I've entitled this, Let's Dream Again. Let's Dream Again. I want you to think about something today. What are your dreams? And I'm not talking about wild and crazy stuff, you know, where you're being chased through a swamp by a seven-legged monster and you got cement shoes on. You know, not those nightmarish types. But I'm talking about, what is your passion in life? What gets your blood pumping? What makes you climb out of bed in the morning and say, let's go? It's going to be a great day. Some of you might say, it's been a while since I had one of those. But what just gets you charged? Because we're all wired a little differently. We talked about that some last week. We're just wired differently. But every one of us has, or we have had, a dream. A dream. I believe the Bible in many ways is a book of dreams, and I mean promised dreams. I love Proverbs 13:12, which says, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a dream fulfilled is a tree of life. A tree of life. I believe the book, the Bible, is a book for dreamers. A people who see the possibilities instead of always seeing the negative. In other words, a people of faith. This is a book of faith, obviously. And I believe God created each of us to dream big dreams. I don't know if my mic's on or what, but I want to say it again. I hate fishing for amens, but I really mean that, folks. I believe God created us to dream big dreams. I believe he put within us some desires, some longings, that your Heavenly Father delights to see come about. Parents, just as you and I love to see the dreams of our children come about, don't you love it when you see your kids do well and their dreams come about and we just say yes, yes. So the Father loves to see your dreams fulfilled. Oh, he delights in it. You know why? Because he put them in your heart in the first place. Now, I want you to notice this, that first of all, God is the originator of dreaming big dreams. All you have to do is look around, for instance, at creation. This is what he dreamed up. I mean, just look at Montana, for instance. Of course, you know, a lot of people, when they think of Montana, they think of Western Montana and mountains and streams and rivers and all those things, you know, snow-capped peaks. But Montana doesn't stop at the center. And I was reminded just yesterday afternoon as we drove up, you know, of course, I was raised in this country. I was raised a little west or east of here, but coming up from Fort Benton, I said to Cordis, look at this. Look at how green it is. And the beauty of the prairie. It just has a beauty that's just amazing. But God dreamed all this up. He gave us deserts, he gave us oceans, he gave us snow-capped peaks, and he gave us prairies. But he is the originator of great, great dreams. And he put that DNA in us when he created us, that we also would dream great dreams. I think about the story of Abraham. Remember, you'll recall the story. One night God takes Abraham out and says, look at the night sky. Go ahead and count the stars, Abraham. If you can, he asks. The obvious thing is you can't. You ever try that? Sometimes I'll get my telescope out, or I'll just go lay on the grass and look at the sky at night. And you start over here, 1, 2, 3, 4, whoop, I lost it. Because there's thousands and thousands and thousands of them. And that's the God we serve. And then Abraham, or God tells Abraham, okay, count those stars if you can. That's how many descendants you're going to have. You remember who he's talking to? A guy who he and his wife are past that age. But it was a promise of God. It was the dream that God put in his heart that night. God was suggesting something that seemed so ridiculous. But partnered with God, the dream came about.
Amen.
So God is the originator of dreaming big dreams. Secondly, I want you to notice this. God loves it when we dream. Oh, he loves that. Psalm 37:4 says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. And really, that's the essence of dreaming big dreams with God. Delighting in him daily, laying our desires before him, seeing them fulfilled. Oh, God loves it. And do you realize that God actually co-labors with us to see our dreams fulfilled? I want you to think about that. God co-labors with us. In other words, he works with us to see our dreams fulfilled. He loves it when we dream God-sized dreams, and he works with us to see them come about. Of course, Jeremiah 29:11 is many people's favorite verse, but he says, I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope. Plans to give you a future. And do you realize who he was talking to? God told people that were in exile that he still had great plans for them. He had a wonderful future ahead. And I want to tell you, God has great plans for you. He has great plans for this church. And it often starts with a dream. I've told you before about a dream I had about planting a church in Helena. Now, I won't go into all those details again, but God laid it on our hearts, but it started in my heart to see another Assembly of God church planted in Helena. Helena had one. It was good. It was strong. It was healthy. It was large. But I couldn't get this thing out of my mind about seeing another church started in the other end of town, not as competition, but just another place to proclaim the kingdom. And this thing began to grow. And I've noticed dreams, they begin to grow in you. Now, if it's just a fancy thought, usually the next day you go, but this thing wouldn't leave me. It wouldn't leave. And all on and on it went, and there were challenges along the way, and there were hurdles, but I'll tell you what, God helped us to plant the church. And really, he of course did it, but he used us to see that dream fulfilled. So what's your dream? Again, maybe it's so personal that you never really shared it with anyone, or maybe those of you who are married, maybe you shared it with your spouse, but that's it. I just encourage you to keep dreaming big dreams for God. And here's something I want to warn about There are things that come along that discourage dreams. They just do. Most of us have probably carried a dream in our heart at some time, but for some reason or another, we never saw it fulfilled. And there's reasons that come up against us. Here's one: fear of failure. What if I step out and do this and it bombs? Won't I look foolish? And of course, often the devil comes along and says, "You'll never make it. It'll never work out. Give it up. You'll look so silly." I just challenge you, friends, don't listen to that stuff. Here's another discourager of dreams. I call it embarrassment. Maybe the dream is so personal and so out of the ordinary that others might think it's silly. And so we just keep it to ourselves, and then we never follow up on it, never pursue our dreams because we're afraid somebody might laugh at us. Listen, they're your dreams. You own them. Go for it. Go for it. Don't ever be embarrassed over your dreams. How about this one? You ever have somebody to say to you, maybe you've shared a dream or you've shared a desire with them, and they say to you, "Oh, be realistic." Sometimes I think being realistic has squelched more dreams than anything else. When we start listing all the boundaries, all the reasons why a dream would never work, and you know the Bible says without faith it's impossible to please God. Every dream has an element of faith in it. So let's not be so realistic that we squelch dreams that people have. Here's another one. Oh, I'm too old. Yeah, that's right. I just turned 65. Can you imagine a young guy like me being 65? That used to be old people. But sometimes it's easy to start saying, "I'm too old for that." Occasionally I've heard this from seniors over the years. Interestingly enough, not in this place. But I've heard it maybe from people approaching their senior years. They'll say, "Oh, I'm too old to dream. Let the younger ones do the dreaming." The Bible says your old men will dream dreams. I think that goes for our ladies too. I think we've stifled so much of what God wants to do when we have that mindset. I love the life of Moses. You realize that he was two-thirds of the way through life before he got called to his most important work. He lived to be 120 and he was 80 years old when God called him to lead the people of Israel. You're never too old. That doesn't mean you don't have some limitations that come with age, of course, but still, you can still dream great dreams for God. And of course, a big one, finally, is just plain discouragement. Just the discouragements of life. Yesterday, I was talking to a pastor who lives in another state. Maybe it was Friday, I forget, but anyway, I was talking to him. Boy, life's been hard. He went through a divorce a number of years ago. He and his ex-wife have three grown children, two of them not doing well. He's had numerous health issues and financial challenges. And he was I mean, it was a tough phone call. And I know this man well. And I sat there listening to him, and I thought, how can I encourage him? And the Lord dropped this in my heart. He said, what are you preaching on Sunday? That stream again. He said, that's what I'd like him to do, is to start dreaming again. Now, I know, folks, when you're at the bottom, it's hard to start dreaming. And we talked for a long time about that, but I just said to him, I called him by name, I said, amen. I think God would like you to start dreaming again. I know you don't feel like it right now. That's the last thing you feel like doing. But then I prayed, God, would you drop a new dream in his heart? He received that. I don't know what you're dealing with today. We all come from different angles and different situations. Maybe you're struggling with discouragement. But I challenge you, and I'm going to be praying for you today at the close, that God would rekindle a new dream in your heart. Because he wants to do such wonderful things for you and through you. I challenge you to be a dream encourager. Be a dream encourager. I think we ought to take that on, that assignment, each of us personally, to encourage other people's dreams. Good teachers, for instance, do that. Whenever I'm in a teaching setting, for instance, maybe a Sunday school class or a midweek Bible study or something like that, and you have interaction, give and take with people, I always operated with that foundational idea that you can't ask a stupid question, you know? Because hey, the reason they ask a question is because they don't know. So no question is dumb. The same thing for me goes with dreams. You ever share your dream with someone and they go, that's silly. Boy, it just kind of squelches it, doesn't it? But when people share a dream with me, I like to say, yes, you can do that with God's help. Do it. Do it. Start it. I told you before about the story about Mark Rutland. I won't go through all that again, but Rutland is now, he travels the world. He's preached in every continent. He's written book after book, but he was raised in a very poor home. And dreams were not encouraged necessarily, but he got in a third grade teacher's class, and she said, what are your dreams? And for the first time in his life, he said, I want to write books. He was a terrible student. He wasn't a good student at all, but he said, I want to write books. She said, yes, yes, that's going to happen. I can see that happening. And he said, that day a dream was planted in his heart. And he's written, I don't know, 18 or 20 books, and they're great books. But it's all because a woman in a little Texas town encouraged a dream. Encouraged a dream. Moms and dads, grandparents, I challenge each of us, let's encourage our children and our grandchildren to dream. I confess to you, I did not do that really, really well when my children were small. I wish I had done it better. I think I got better as they got a little older and I understood the value of dreaming, but I didn't do it really well at first. But why not encourage our kids to dream big dreams? Husbands and wives, encourage your spouse. Encourage them to dream. Perhaps your spouse is in a dead-end job that they drag themselves to every day, but they have a dream for something better. Why not encourage them? Or maybe it's a skill of some kind. Maybe they've always wanted to play the piano or learn a foreign language or build a house or plant a flower garden. Or what? You know, we can list thousands of things. Why not encourage them? Encourage them. Same with friends. Be an encourager of dreams. And finally, I want to challenge us today in closing. Let's be a church that dreams.
Amen.
Let's be a church that dreams here at Chester Assembly. I've been around church all my life. Some of you have as well, I know it. I love to see a church that dreams, but I also know this, it's so easy for a church to slide into complacency. Hey, been there and done that. To begin thinking, this is the way we've always done it, and this is probably the way we'll always do it. We come every week, we have a service, we sing a few songs, we hear a sermon. We go home, then next week we do it again, alone. And I want you to hear me today. God has so much more for this church than just business as usual. I'm going to say that again. God has so much more for this church than just business as usual. God himself has great dreams for this church. And part of his dream for this church is found in the pastor he's chosen. Notice, he chose. And you might say, well, our leadership met with him, no, and we voted as a congregation and so on. Hey, God uses vehicles, but he chose your new pastor. And you have a wonderful pastoral team coming in Chad and Jill Smith. And listen, they are going to have God-given dreams that will only be fulfilled with your loving and prayerful support. I challenge you to encourage them as they come and as they begin to dream big dreams. Listen, first of all, this is just common sense, I know, but give them plenty of room to get established in this community and get their family settled, get their feet on the ground, all those things. You know, moving to a new community, it takes time to adjust, so help them as they do so. And then I want you to hear this carefully. Will you please give them time to simply grow as leaders? You see, Pastor Chad, he's been in ministry for some time, but this is his first lead pastoring. And I can speak from experience. It's just a very different thing to lead pastor. I was a staff pastor for 12 years, loved it. Thought I'd be there all my life, and God called me to be a lead pastor. And I loved that too, but it was a way different deal. Okay, it's hard to even explain. I'm going to put it this way. There's a different weight in the spirit realm on a lead pastor. And again, I wish I could make it more clear than that, but there's just a different responsibility. There's a different weight. Now, I have known many, many pastors over the years. I've known district leaders. I've been close friends with many of them. Do you know what they all have in common? Do you know what we pastors have in common? Just like perhaps all of you, but all we pastors have this in common. Each one I've known has had incredible strengths. Areas they just excel in and do so well. And then each of them have had areas they're growing in. As I've looked back over the pastors and leaders I've known, I thought, man, that's true. Everyone has had great strengths, things they just excel in, things that just come naturally to them. And then there's areas they are growing in and maturing in, and God is developing them in. Pastor Chad will be the same. He will have strength areas which he will recognize right away, and he'll have some areas he's growing in. But I sense that this church and the love you've shown us is going to spill over all over them, and you're just going to be blessed, and you're going to bless them. So in all of this, I urge you to walk alongside them, pray for he and Jill regularly, always encourage their dreams, and as this church dreams together, I believe we will see Chester and this surrounding area touched in such a mighty way for the kingdom of God. Friends, there's great days ahead. Great days. I believe we're in great days right now, but there's great days ahead. And so much of it has to do with the faithfulness of God. He's just so faithful. Worship team, I'd like you to come back up here. As we're going to close the service here in a few minutes, but I want us to sing that chorus we were singing earlier, just as an acknowledgement to the Lord. All my life, you have been faithful. But you know what? A blessing is a very real thing. Oh, you can't see it, touch it, maybe, and feel it, but it's very real. The spirit realm comes to us. And so I want to speak a blessing over you today. And it's a familiar one, but I want to do it in a couple of different versions. This one's probably the most familiar. It's in number 6, great priestly blessing. Would you just receive it right now? Perhaps just put your hands out if you're comfortable doing that. Just receive it as though I were putting something in your lap. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. I want to read it out of one other translation. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. No, I like this. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. And Lord, I pray that right now over Chester Assembly of God. Thank you for this precious, wonderful family. And I pray, Lord, I declare it over them. May you bless each person. Each person who's here today, those who are not, who could not make it today. But I just pray for this family. Would you bless them and protect them, Lord? I pray your protection over every family, over every child, over every marriage, over people's finances, over the heart of this church, Lord. Would you just protect this place? Lord, would you smile on this church and be gracious to them? And Lord, I pray that you would show your favor in this house. And Lord, as Pastor Chad and Jill come in, I pray your favor on them. Help them today as they say goodbye to a dear church family. Protect them as they travel up here this week. Lord, I just pray your blessing on them in every way. And I give you thanks and give you praise. In the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Terry?
Friendship this last year has grown so much that he told me in the last year that I've gotten more gray hair.
It runs off.
And of course, I told him if they hadn't been here, I'd be as gray headed as he was. but they have, in my and Star's heart, they have just found a special place so quick in the year that they've been here. And we appreciate them so much. We appreciate them listening to the voice of God,
yes,
calling them here to serve during this time of transition for us. And I appreciate your message this morning of dreams. Those in the congregation may not be aware, but within the last probably 2 years or more, church leadership has, within our board meetings, has talked. And I guess it was kind of a dream of transitioning from a piano to a keyboard. I don't know how many of you know that, but that has been within a topic within the board meetings well over 2 years. And shortly after they were here, I mentioned it to Pastor Norm that, you know, the church had been talking about getting rid of the piano and going to a keyboard. He said, well, if you ever do that, let me know. I don't know if he remembers that conversation or not, but he did. And You know, and it's amazing how God fulfills our dreams, even as with the church leadership. Because one reason we had no place to place this piano within this transition, and no place of knowing where to put it. But when he said that, then it didn't register with us right then. But as we talked more in the board meeting, and we have come to the conclusion that we want to bless Pastor Norman Corlin with this piano.
Yeah.
And from what I understand, it'll fit in their living room. So, and I was sitting there thinking of, during his message for his last, about how God fulfills dreams and how he makes a way for things. And I really feel that he made a way, a possible way for this piano to be still used in ministry. You know, because I've walked in on Sunday mornings, the first one in here, and I've walked in, and Pastor Norm, he said, "Behind this piano," and he'd be playing. And you could just feel the anointing and the Spirit of God coming from that piano as he played. And I'm sure that him and Coraline both sit behind the piano at home and play. And I think that's the way they get along with God. And they get behind that piano. And you, if you're not a musician, you guys, you really got to understand it. You may not understand it. When you get behind that and you just play, and you just get along with God, God just speaks to you and ministers to you.
That's right.
And so this piano is still going to be used in ministry. Because he's going, they're both set behind it, and they'll play, and God will speak to them and guide them and lead them. And they will be alone in the presence of God. So with, we just want to present this to you guys and show you that we love you and we appreciate you. And God's already worked out a way. We've already purchased a keyboard. And so that will be here next Sunday. So with that, there's also cards in the back. I don't know if you're aware, but there's a card, a basket of cards in the foyer for you guys. And we just want to say we love you and appreciate you. Board members?
Just to clarify it a little bit. This piano has been released. Dan and Holly and Laura have said, if we can give it to somebody, please do. I just want to let you guys know that. And see if I can get through this. I don't know if anybody caught it during the songs today, but we sang that little verse of Jesus loves me. You guys remember another time that it was sang for the community and for the school? I see Teresa.
I had Courtney in my class.
Yep. And I just got chills when those words came on the screen. And I knew I needed to say something about that. You know, it was the piano was done with memorial money. But the people that were involved with that have released it. So we just want to bless you too with it. It does mean a lot to this church. And so do you guys. For years, your presence for this last year is going to be felt. And we just want to just wish you well in the next chapter, what you guys are going to be doing. And we just thank you for being here for us.
Amen. I guess all I can say is amen. Yeah, what a blessing.
Emotional words.
Yeah, that's okay. That's all right. It is. It's going to be different. You know, this day is bittersweet. We knew it would always come.
Yeah.
We tried to convince you to stay repeatedly, but we all knew that it was coming. And as you guys shepherd the shepherds and other flocks, it will be just a blessing. We're going to miss out, but it's going to be great. You guys are amazing.
Oh. So.
What a blessing. Our family, the church family.
Yes, you may. Yes, you may.
And I just wanted to add how much we have loved you guys. And it's been a real honor and a privilege to be here with you. I think of Paul when he talked to the Philippian church and he said, I have you in my heart. That's the way we feel. We have you in our heart. And what makes it so great is you're family now. We can think of you here as our church family, and we will. And we'll think of you often, especially with that small reminder in our living room about how wonderful you've been. And even though a year ago things were different and there was a lot of hurt, but you guys have learned to trust. You have been restored and you've been so faithful to open your hearts. And thank you for your opening your heart to us. And I ask that you will open your heart to Pastor Chad and Jill. Embrace them and trust them like you trusted us. So I just want to add our blessings, my blessings to you, to all of you, because I'll have you in my heart.
If you were just, we wanted to anoint Pastor Warren and for them as they go on and allow the Lord to minister to them and through them. So if you'll just, if you'd like to stand or reach out your hand, we're just going to pray a prayer of blessing upon them.
Thank you.